Hello, multi-millennial malt masticators. I'm Ralfy, in the bothy. Extras, 885 extras. And a big thank you to Sashi Day for that malt mention. Now, the thing about an extras is that I extend the range of my whisky conversation beyond a specific review of a specific spirit. And in the case of Ralfy Review 855, my specific spirit has been Pike Creek from Ontario in Canada, because it is a malternative, and I highly recommend that all Scotch single malt drinkers buy a bottle of rum, bottle of bourbon, bottle of Canadian whiskey, and a bottle of whiskey from somewhere else in the world, because they're going to last you a long, long, long time. And when you're drinking your Scotch whiskey, you can compare and contrast with these malternatives. It's actually really good to give our whisky palates a rest before they become, our palates become institutionalized and jaded with simply too much constant exposure to Scotch whiskey, which gives a certain performance. It's a certain theme, from light and complex through to sherry monsters and peat monsters and everything in between. But it's malted barley spirit, and malted barley spirit behaves a certain way. And other grains behave differently. An obvious example is rye. And to have spirits that are, say, rum or mezcal or Canadian separate mash bill whiskies, if you source good quality ones, they're really good to contrast and compare with Scotch whiskey, and even at times to blend. Because it's amazing, if you've got a Scotch whiskey which is lacking in cask influence, a drop of Canadian whiskey which is strong in cask influence will provide that cask top-up that's missing from the Scotch single malt. And basically what you're doing is, in the sanctuary of your own malt cave, your own whiskey corner, you are blending your own, you are literally glass finishing, bottle finishing like a cask finish. You're bottle finishing by adding a few drops of a different spirit into your whiskey, which will influence that whiskey you've got roughly in the same way. Not specifically, but generally and roughly in the same way that casks like rum casks can add a finish and a different certain temperament and a different identity and character to a Scotch single malt whiskey. There you go. But what I want to talk about in this extras is an issue that's happening at the moment involving the Scotch Whiskey Association. Now, before I start, I just want to remind you at this stage that what I am presenting here is purely a personal opinion and perspective. When you read the description box down below, you will see in every video that I post on YouTube that it is, in fact, from the bothy, a personal opinion and perspective, and should be taken as such. But the reason my channel started 2009 was because there's a little distillery in Nova Scotia. Clues in the word Nova Scotia, New Scotland, in the east coast of Canada, the eastern seaboard, called Glenbretton. And they created a little bottling of whiskey from Glenbretton Distillery, which lies 60 miles south of Inverness, Canada. And the Scotch Whiskey Association, on behalf of their financiers, who are by and large the corporate multinationals that dominate Scotch whiskey, and that is just my perspective, just giving it a reality check here, they asked Glenbretton Distillery to discontinue the use of names in their product which the Scotch Whiskey Association considered could be confused with Scotch whiskey, despite the maple leaf on the label and the made in Canada on the label. So it became a prolonged court case. A lot of money was spent by both sides on lawyers. And at the end of it, Glenbretton won the right to use the name Glenbretton because the name is indigenous to Canadian culture's recent history. It does not belong in place names, and geographical names are not the exclusive property of corporate multinationals. You know, it's like calling your whiskey, it's like, say, for example, green label, black label, red label, and then trying to ban, you know, paint and art shops because they're red and green and yellow and blue as well. Where does this start and end? And I felt the real reason that the Scotch Whisky Association took Glenbretton to court over the use of the name that could be confused with a Scotch whisky, if you had a passing glance at it, was more to do with the fact that Glenbretton was one of a new generation of small distilleries producing single malt, malted barley spirit in the style of a Scotch whisky. It has since been followed most notably by Tasmania. Tasmania hit the ground with some spectacularly good quality, popular, highly desirable single malt, malted barley spirits, which are now contained due to limited quality, quantity, availability, and high prices. You see, historically, two countries in the world which were always a threat to the dominance of Scotch whisky in the production of malted barley spirit have been New Zealand and Canada. Why? Because they have, in these countries, similar environments to Scotland, similar landscapes to Scotland. New Zealand, it's a no-brainer. And in fact, rhetorically, allegedly, that's better, allegedly, the investors, when they were setting up the infrastructure in New Zealand, back in the 19th century, made it clear, no distilleries, or we won't build your railroads and your roads and all the rest of it, and won't give you the finance. So there was protectionism going on. And that, by the way, I totally believe, because it's real life. It's just real life. There's no point in denying it and being sentimental and all dewy-eyed. That's the real world. And of course, Canada as well has areas, particularly in the East Coast and the West Coast, which avoid the deep freeze of central Canada, particularly these long, dark winters, which many Scots immigrants over the last 200 odd years have adapted to wonderfully well. And talking of which, if you're looking for Caledonian societies who celebrate burn suppers and have Highland games, you'll find an awful lot of these societies in Canada. Such is the strength of Scottish culture, which has been adopted by that country over a long period of time due to the influence of Scots who were forced out of Scotland, or who had to buy their way out of Scotland because there was zero opportunities in their own home country due to the likes of clearances, industrialisation, and other misplaced plans which really in the long term didn't amount to much. It's an opinion. Now that was 12 years ago, and it kind of, the Glenbretton situation kicked off my channel because I was angry. I was angry that Scottish culture was being appropriated as an exclusivity of corporate multinationals who only tolerate that Scottishness because it sells their brand. To be honest, if it didn't, they wouldn't give a damn. That's an opinion. So it's kicking off again, isn't it? And it's happening with a small distillery in British Columbia. Very good place for producing malted barley whiskey. Good community support. Very civilized people who appreciate good quality whiskey. Particularly a whiskey that wins lots of award and gets accoladed as the world's best peated whiskey. I thought you might like to know that about this distillery as well. It's called MacAloney'sDistillers.com. Macaloney, little distillery. And they've got themselves in a pickle because they've received a lawyer's letter from the Scotch Whiskey Association asking them to desist in the use of a Scottish name, Macaloney, and also the reference of Caledonia in their branding. Now, what the Scotch Whiskey Association are suggesting is that the word Caledonia is going to be confused with Scotch whisky and is an exclusive owned reference by Scotch whisky, basically. Now, as I say, this is an opinion, a perspective. And personally, I think this is bollocks. This is nonsense. I just like to counter that by saying that the Scotch Whisky Association are very relevant and important to manage in managing the interests and protecting the reputation of Scotch whisky globally against fakes and rip-offs and all sorts of shenanigans that go out there. However, in this instance, times have changed. It's not 12 years ago when one little distillery completely out on its own basically survived, but it was damaged. Glen Breton was damaged by the sheer costs and the stress of fighting a court case that they won. And now the Scotch Whisky Association are doing something similar with another distillery, but times have changed. Because we now have Reddit and Instagram and Twitter, and they are full of specialist whisky groups which are 20 to 30 times the size that they were 12 years ago. And unlike 12 years ago, these people are taking far more of a proactive interest in the situation with Macaloney. As regards a solution, I think there should be a third way solution. I think what's important is that the Macaloney distillery do not get put through the ringer of court cases, and in particular the excessive costs which are being removed from investment in the core quality of the product. And I think that the distillery should say, right, Scotch Whisky Association, if we can't use Macaloney, you tell us what we can use. You tell us the name and we'll put it out to all the Canadian whisky fans to vote on it. In fact, what we're going to do is we're going to have a pan-Canadian lottery. The Scotch Whisky Association are threatened by us. Is it our name of our distillery, or is it in fact the exceptional quality of our product, which is getting the Scotch Whisky Association's backers knickers in a twist? Because this distillery is proving that there are better Scotch whiskies in the world other than Scotch whisky from Scotland. And this is the way it's being read. It's a different age we live in, different messages, things are more complex. And as for the other word Caledonian, I think there's an imaginative change to Canadonian. The Scotch Whisky Association cannot take issue with a Canadian distillery using the word Canadonian. They can't. Otherwise, they'd be a laughing stock. And on top of that, they would so offend many Scotch whisky fans in Canada that it could lead to a boycott of Scotch whisky, probably in November, which will be Canada Whisky Month. What pisses me off slightly is Scotch Whisky Association needs to protect Scotch whisky's reputation, but to do it intelligently. In other words, if a country that has no Scottish connection starts to use overt Scottish imagery and names, it's completely different to a culture, a country, where Scottish names are the absolute norm. They are indigenous to the modern contemporary culture of that country. They are part of its core identity, contemporary identity. This could really backfire in the Scotch Whisky Association, and it's costing them a lot of money. Guess who provides that money? The profits from the members of the Scotch Whisky Association, which is probably one reason why we're paying more and more for our whisky. Who said it was easy? I think that Canadian distillers should try and swerve round straight-on confrontation in a way that gets the maximum international publicity and sympathy for the brand, and importantly, makes the distiller's identity visible right across the Canadian nation, which will foster a loyalty and an appreciation of what Canadian whisky can be, which is a local whisky, and it's cheaper than the imported Scotch, and it's of the country, of the people, of the community, of the culture, and it's to be endorsed and to be supported and to be invested in with the buying bottles of it. And I can tell you right now, when Macaloney's whisky becomes available in the UK, which I hope it does, when there's enough to reach out beyond the shores of Canada, I hope that it will arrive somewhere in the British Isles with an age statement, unchill filtered, natural colour, cask only colour, 46%, and a reasonable price tag, because I look forward to buying a bottle and reviewing it. To conclude, I think the Scotch Whisky Association do a good job, a necessary job. They're a good thing to have. And I think that the Canadian Whisky Association should be fighting more for Canadian distillers and reaching more of an amicable agreement which does not squander money needlessly on very, very expensive legal fees, which frankly means that nobody's a winner at the end of the day. Because if it happened, you know, you can see this far enough. A business sets up, right? You see, this is the next move here. A distillery sets up. They're very small. And they call themselves Caledonian Canadian Scotch. Hey. And they just wait for that Scotch Whisky Association lawyer's letter. Because they're going to get publicity. They're going to get visibility that no marketing consultants could possibly afford to provide them. It's just so easy to play all this. And it's different times because things are moving online. Anyway, I've said enough. I'm going to leave it at that. That's my penny's worth. I hope, particularly for you Canadian whisky fans, you find this supportive and helpful. And I hope that for all you whisky fans beyond Canada, you now know that there's a distillery called Macaloni. And you're going to visit their site and learn more about them and wish them luck in their court case. I'm Ralfy.
I'm done and dusted. Thank you for watching. And I'll see you soon, mates. Bye-bye.